The biggest river in Waterbury is the Naugatuck River. It slices the city in half as it cuts through the Naugatuck Valley.
Two important neighborhoods developed along the Naugatuck River: Waterville to the north, Brooklyn on the south.
In the 1850s, two railroad lines came into Waterville, each with its own station. With water to power the mills and trains to bring in materials and take away the finished products, Waterville attracted the new immigrant workers and the neighborhoods grew.
First came the Irish and Germans, and they were followed by the Canadians, Poles, and Italians. Let's listen to the memories of people who grew up in Waterville.
My mom and dad came to this country from Italy. My dad was a foundry worker at Scovel's on Thomaston Avenue, and my mom was a housewife. We'd have a big garden and chickens, and we used to have goats and fresh eggs. I guess that is the way everybody lived on Thomaston Avenue in those days. And in those days, there was no heat in the house. One light in the kitchen, cold water. We used to heat it on our wood stove and a coal stove. There was no hot water in those days. The only light we had was in the kitchen. That was 1929. Michelina Cirillo.
The streets were the lifeblood of Waterville. And if you lived on the lower end of Thomaston Avenue, you had the Waterbury Corrugated, you had Blake and Johnson, True Love and McLean, Verjun Manufacturing, which was on Chapel Street, and you had the big ones of Scoville's and Chase Brass and Copper. And then you had Row Bottoms, where my father worked. Bob Brown.
The houses on Chase Avenue were little bungalows. There was a field across the street, and there were actually ponies there. Down the street, we had Frog Pond, where the boys and men in the neighborhood would fish for bluegills and sunfish. Nina Cherubino. My mother was a dressmaker and worked at the dry cleaners. My father worked at Chase Brass as a crane operator. We'd go to Sprague School, go home, do our chores, and then we were allowed to play with the neighborhood kids. We went to Lawdon's on Sheffield Street to swim. It was a good pond. Celeste Panassi.
There was Howard Walcott's Market, which was a place you'd go on Saturday afternoon, or early in the evening, because he'd have the ball game on, and just as kids would listen to the games. You'd sit there and you'd argue about the Red Sox and the Yankees. In 1951 or 1952, we got the Ville Theater. We thought that was the absolute best. We had our own theater to go to. Robert Brown. Now let's look at another neighborhood on the Naugatuck River, Brooklyn. We played baseball at Porter Street Park. A rock was first base. If you found a beer can, you crushed it down. That was second base. And we used to give this kid a dime to stand by the sewer, because if you pulled the ball out of the park and it rolled down the sewer, that was it. You didn't have another ball. Frank Perella. You had a YMCA in Brooklyn. Brooklyn YMCA. Hundreds of kids tracked down there, took showers down there, practiced on their basketball down there. We had a lot of good teams from Brooklyn in those days. You had a library right in Brooklyn. Brooklyn Library. You had a Lithuanian market. Most of the stores were Italian, but you had this one market that was Lithuanian. The Lithuanians, the Polish, the Italians, and the Irish was what Brooklyn consisted of. It was like the United Nations. We all got along good. Ray Bazzuto. My two best friends when I was growing up, Freddie Edmonds, an African American, and Mickey Perez, Puerto Rican. We grew up together. I ate over Freddie's house. I had chitlins over his house. And at Mickey Perez's, we had rice and beans, and they ate macaroni at my house. And we didn't know what prejudice was because we didn't experience it. Frank Perella.